Thank you, Sazad. First of all, I would like also to thank the organizer and Giorgio Righetti and Sazad and Fabrizio for inviting me here and being here with you. And I'm very honored also that I'm following Neil Charman in his talk. He's also my supervisor, my tutor for many years in Manchester. I also liked the first talks, although they were in Italian. I can speak some Italian. I will not test it now. On definition of presbyopia and presbyty, and I would suggest that because presbyty in Greek is a word that defines old man, and because presbyopes are supposed not to be very old, I mean, I'm a presbyope, but I hope I'm not an old man, I would suggest to use the word presbyopity, which would mean a man with old eye. Okay? So would be more correct to define presbyopia than presbyty. Today I will discuss the aging eye and the normal, the healthy eye. I will not talk about disease and how its performance may be limited due to optical and neural factors. I will talk about the pupil and the lens. There are not many changes in the cornea. There are some changes on the tears, but I will not focus on them. Then on the refraction and aberration, scatter light, and on retinal image quality and visual acuity. And also, I will focus on light sensitivity and spectral sensitivity, and also spatial vision, binocular vision, which are the neural changes that may affect visual performance in the aging eye. Before I go into optical and neural changes, I have three, four slides about accommodation and presbyopia. And actually, this is what Neil Charman showed before, the loss of amplitude of accommodation with age that seems to be linear from a very early age. And what I did here, I replotted the data from Duan, very old data, since 1922, where he measured this monocularly and binocularly. And you see the binocular points are the blue dots. If you take the difference between these two, then you see the binocular advantage, what is advantage we have with the two eyes. And you will see that we have about one diopter when we are very young, about 10 to 15, and this drops to 40 and 50 years. There seems to be some increase there, but maybe not many points to give accurate data. But seems to be a loss of amplitude of accommodation that it gives us with binocular vision. This may be the fact that when we are young, we converge our eyes and we can accommodate very near. So there is some extra convergence-driven accommodation and help us to see better than that. So we have to see this because it's important, I think, for presbyopia corrections using different types of methods. The other fact is that you may know that we don't accommodate as accurate as we can. So this is defined by this graph where it shows our response as our response as a function of our the target vertex, our demand. And this dotted line corresponds to one-to-one, so we accommodate as much as we should accommodate. And you can see that even in a young, fairly young eye, 33 years of age, there is some lag of accommodation for near targets. So as we have to accommodate for closer targets, we accommodate a bit less. And you see this is the same subject, again, longitudinal. Actually, it's my eye. Okay, I'm not 39 now. I have the other data. I have not fitted that yet. And you see that there is a loss of accommodation for near targets, but also there is a loss for intermediate targets. So the accommodative amplitude may show us how that we cannot accommodate a lot at near, but we should always think and remember that we also lose an intermediate distance even at these early ages. Another figure that I find very interesting, although it's very old, it's since 1961, is the one that's showing what happens to the near triad. This is, we know that when we accommodate, we converge at the same time, and our pupil is becoming smaller. And this is a 38-year-old subject who was asked to accommodate, okay? And you will see that, when the target was coming closer, he was converging, but he was accommodating, but when the accommodative demand was higher than 3 diopters, closer than 33 centimeters, then he could not accommodate anymore. But he could still converge, so we know that we converge even for closer subjects and stimuli. Moreover, his pupil diameter was also becoming smaller as he was accommodating and as the target was coming closer. And you can see that although he could not accommodate anymore for close targets, his pupil was still becoming smaller, which means that we may become older, we may not be able to accommodate, our lens may not be effective to change its parameters, but our pupil becomes smaller, and this may give us some advantage because of depth of focus, so better visual at near. And this is further emphasized, this is very complicated, I understand, but it's again a very interesting figure from a general physiology article from Schiefel back in 1993, who showed that this accommodative induced meiosis is not the same for all ages. On the top left, there is a 7-year-old subject, and you understand a 7-year-old subject has a lot of reserves in accommodation, who was asked to accommodate to a near target of about 7 diopters. And you could see that this was a step response, and you could see that very easily he could accommodate. And he didn't need to have any change in his pupil, because his reserves probably in accommodation are so high that his pupil doesn't need to change to help in increasing depth of focus. If you see the same experiment in 26-year-old subject, you will see that the response is limited compared to the previous one, but there is some change in his pupil diameter, higher than the previous one. Now, a subject of 38 years of age, you will see that the response now is limited. It's only 2.5 to 3 diopters for that target. And there is a bigger step change in pupil size, so pupil becomes smaller, and this may help to give better vision at near. And then this is an early presbyope, but a presbyope at 48 years of age, actually my age, and you will see that the step change in accommodation may be only 0.30 to 0.40 diopters, but his pupil size may change for 2.5 millimeters, but not okay very constantly, maybe sporadically and sometimes, and this may give some better depth of focus. So even if you get older, don't forget to try to accommodate. Your pupil may become smaller and may see better. Okay? This may not happen if we wear glasses, so that's something that may give us better vision without glasses, the pupil becoming smaller at near. What about other changes? And one of the important changes that happen with aging is pupil size, as I said before. Not because we accommodate only, but because we're becoming older. And this graph very nice shows how pupil diameter change as a function of luminance. We know that at very bright conditions, pupil becomes smaller for four different age groups. So these are 35ers, 45, 55, 65. First of all, we can see the effect of aging. As we become aged, the pupil becomes smaller by about 1.5 millimeter in the dark and maybe about 1 millimeter at bright light conditions, but also that our pupil becomes smaller at very bright light conditions. And imagine these are measurements usually done in monocularly, and we should not forget that with two eyes, we have more light coming into our retina and our brain, and our pupils tend to even decrease more by about 0.5 millimeter. And why I say this? Because you know that most of the designs for contact lenses and IOLs for presbyopia correction are pupil dependent. So we talk sometimes for designs up to 6 millimeters and 5.5 millimeters, but you understand in a bright light conditions for a 55-year-old subject, his pupil is never higher than 5 millimeters, sometimes maybe 4 to 4.5 millimeters. Okay, this may give better vision for near-center designs, but his far vision may not be very adequate. So we should take this into account. Pupil is very important. And again, as I say, we become older, pupil becomes smaller, and this may give us increased depth of focus and help us to better register blur and fight blur and have better vision. And also, we should not forget that in elderly subjects who are vulnerable in light, this may also protect them from more light coming into their retina. So they may another advantage. However, you probably are aware that many patients who are old, because of the transmittance of the lens and their aging of their retina, they need more and more light. So pupil becoming smaller sometimes may not be so good, because their mesopic and scotopic vision may be degraded. So we should not forget, because most of, again, of the studies that simulate retinal image quality on the retina, they don't take into account pupil, and that the fact that when pupil becomes smaller, less light goes into the retina. And probably I like light a lot more now than 10 years ago. I want more and more light. And this doesn't have to do with my correction. Even if I have good correction for near, I like more light. So light seems to something to be important that has not been studied a lot in the recently. And why is important? Okay, this is another nice slide that also Nils Harman showed, showing how the lens changes at different ages its shape, but also it shows how the optical density of this lens changes with age, how transmittance is reduced. So you see, even in a 33-year-old subject, lens is absorbing some of the light, and 45 years of age, this may be more. So spectral transmittance is decreased with aging, and this can be seen better in this figure, which shows, again, transmittance in percentage as a function of wavelength, and it has two different subjects, one of 13 years of age and another one of 63 years of age, and you will see that transmittance is less for the 63-year-old subject. Mainly, the absorbance is most for blue, 400 to 500, you understand less because the lens probably becomes yellow and absorbs more blue light, but there is an effect for all wavelengths, so less light comes into the retina. And if we add this to the fact that pupil becomes smaller, then we would expect the luminance at the 60 years of age on the retina to be three times less than that was when we were 10. Okay, someone would say that this is a big change, but we should not forget, and I will mention later, that may be some adaptation effects, that maybe we also adapt to less quantity of light. But light seems to be an important parameter. Another change that may affect, again, presbyopia correction, mainly, is the spherical aberration changes with age. Because the lens shape, the crystalline lens shape changes with age, and the radius of cables become more curved, then what happens? Spherical aberration increases, positive spherical aberration. We know that a young eye, on average, has positive spherical aberration. And you see that this increased by about 0.10 diopters per millimeter square with age. These are three different studies that don't agree to each other, but they show that there is an increase in spherical aberration. And why I say this is important? Because most of the aspheric multifocal designs, what they offer is they induce negative spherical aberration. So you understand that someone who uses this design when he's 40 may counteract his positive spherical aberration, may give better vision, but when he becomes 55 and then his spherical aberration is increased, maybe the induced spherical aberration of the contact lens or the ILA is not enough, and the effect is less pronounced. But again, pupil may help us a bit, because as I said, it decreases with age, so it may reinforce the vision at near, because these are mostly center near designs. So they have the center at the near visual part at the center of the lens. But again, this should be taken into account when talk about presbyopia correction. Another point that was also mentioned by Nils Harman is that the refraction changes with age. And this is something that usually we miss in the clinical practice. You know, there are some people coming and be happy when we give them a multifocal correction when they are in early 40s or in 40s, and then after 4 or 5 years, they may be not so happy. We should not forget that their refraction may have changed. And we know that refraction at early ages is hypermetropic. These are, again, cross-sectional data from different studies, many different studies from different years, but what they all agree is that our refraction from hyperopic at early ages becomes emmetropic myopic nowadays, okay? But for elderly subjects, elderly participants, again, there is a shift to hyperopia. So we expect the eye to become more hyperopic or less myopic with age between 40 and 60, so we should test their far vision all the time and see if they need less minus or more plus, and this may give us, you understand, better vision at near. So again, it's a point that we should always look when we do refraction, for example. And why the eye shifts to hyperopia? It was, again, partly explained by Nils Harman. We would expect the eye, because of the lens becoming more and more curved, with age to become more myopic. Why should is becoming hyperopic? And the reason is the one that was reinforced by Neil Charman. He said that the refractive index of the cortex, this is the decreases with age, and this changes the power, the gradient index of the lens, but also its power. So on the average eye, we expect the average eye to become less myopic or more hyperopic with age. What about the retinal image quality? What are the effects with aging? We said that there is an increase in aberrations. We know also that there is an increase in scatter light. I didn't talk about scatter. I don't think it's enough time to cover everything. All this would affect the image quality of the eye. And this graph shows the modulation transfer function, which is, a way to simulate quality of the retinal image as a function of spatial frequency for a 29-year-old versus a 64-year-old subject. And you will see that is a decrease in across all spatial frequencies, mainly middle and high spatial frequencies for older subjects. Of course, as we said again, pupil becomes smaller, and this may help us to have better vision and better depth of focus by limiting aberration and scatter light. Okay? This is not shown here because all these data are for similar pupil sizes. Okay? This data may be more representative of the effects of aberrations and other and neural changes in the aging eye because it shows how visual acuity changes with age. And this is logmar visual acuity, which means that as we go up, we have worse visual acuity. Okay, as we go down, we have better visual acuity. And here, zero is the 6-6, or 100%, as we say. You will see all the subjects can see better than 6-6 if we correct them well. Okay, so 6-6 is not the criteria of best vision, and we know this again in the clinical practice. And definitely, there is better vision at the age of 25 to 30, and there is a linearly drop, you will see, in normal eyes that have no other ocular pathologies, okay, with age. So a subject of 75 years of age, if he has no other problems, no cataract, no other retinal pathologies, then you would expect his vision to be about 6-6 or 100%, slightly decreased about 30%, 25 to 30% to the visual acuity of a young person. I will move on neural changes in the aging eye. And first of all, I will focus on light sensitivity again. And you are probably aware of the dark adaptation curve, which is a curve that we get when a participant is exposed to bright light, and then we leave them in total darkness, and gradually we measure his threshold, his light in light sensitivity. And we know that when we close the lights here, after some time, all of us will have the ability to see better. This is a dark adaptation. And it has two curves, because the first one is attributed to cones that are faster and have higher sensitivity in bright light conditions. And this is followed by a second one that is contributed to rods. And you will see that these are dark adaptation. This is a very old graph. Actually, my PhD was dark adaptation. That's the reason I'm aware of the literature, and they saw that there is about a 2 to 3 logarithmic units decrease in threshold with aging, which is about 1,000 times, okay? This is not a less. And we know that this may happen because of the crystalline lens transparency decreasing, because of the pupillary meiosis again, or changes in retinal metabolism, decreasing rod numbers. We know that there is about 30% decrease in rods by the age of 80 compared to the age of 40. So there is a decrease in rod sensitivity. Today we have more data about this, and we know that there are losses in visual sensitivity that occur both at scotopic and photopic light levels. Here are some data showing how the cone sensitivity decreases with age, and actually it's very interesting because they managed to isolate different types of cones. So these are S, blue cones, M cones, which are the green ones, and L cones, long wavelength, which are the red ones. And you see that there is a decrease in sensitivity with years, so there is a loss also in cones, not only rods. And this again is a curve that shows how much time it takes to reach the final threshold for people as a function of age. And again, it's very interesting that you need to do the same experiment differently for each subject, because old people may need 50 minutes to reach their maximum dark adaptation compared to younger ones who may reach this at 35 minutes. So it takes not only their sensitivities reduced in the dark, but it takes more time for them to get dark adapted. What about their spatial contrastivity? I mean, this is spatial vision, better defined compared to visual acuity, and probably you're aware of the contrastivity function, which is plotted as a function of spatial frequency, and shows that profile. We have better sensitivity for medium spatial frequencies compared to high spatial frequencies, which we know they're affected mostly by blur. And these data are for two different groups of 23 years of age and 76 years of age. And they are interesting data because first, they have been done with normal, say, eyesight. So the red one here is for old people, and the blue, the dark blue one is for young. And then they corrected their aberrations using adaptive optics, so they bypassed their optics to see how performance will be improved in these subjects. And you will see that in both groups there was an improvement. Maybe it was slightly more the improvement for old subjects compared to young subjects, but again, the dust curves here shows the difference, which is only due to neural changes. So someone would say, yes, there is a drop in contrastivity for older subjects, but this is mostly due to neural changes and less due to optical changes. So again, this is a nice study showing this. The other fact that is a bit surprising is has to do with color discrimination. We would expect people, as they get older and as their lens becomes more and more cataractous and absorbing more blue light, to shift our color perception. So people with these eyes not to be able to see the colors. And this is surprising because it may change actually the real data as we measure, but it doesn't change color naming. So there is some perception method there where you ask the subjects to name the colors that they see. And you see that irrespective of the optical density of their lens at 400 nanometers, which affects the blue, you see here someone has only one, someone else has 2.73, which is about 100 times more. Okay? The color naming was about the same. So, and this may be due to the long-term adaptation to the slow-changing lens coloration associated with aging. So, although we expect to be a big difference in colors, this may not be the case at the end of the day. Another interesting stuff has to do with binocular summation. Binocular summation defines not only, before I talked about accommodative amplitude, but it defines the better spatial vision we have with two eyes compared with one eye. This some data representative of this, which shows the again spatial frequencies here, so it's contrast sensitivity. The red here squares show data with two eyes, and the blue one with a better eye. And you will see that our contrast sensitivity increased by about 70% for all spatial frequencies. You see, this is the difference, so it's the same across all spatial frequencies with two eyes. So in high contrast letter, our two eyes may not help us a lot. We may see better 5 to 10%, but when we talk about contrast threshold and very low contrast, then there is an improvement with our two eyes. Now, there are some data and some publications in the 90s, you see the one from Pardon, actually there are three, four from the here group, showing that the binocular summation is not so high in older subjects compared to younger ones. And this may be the fact because the two eyes, they differ slightly, they aged slightly differently. Okay? So not only they have different performance, but maybe not as good fusion as they had in the past. So this may drop binocular summation. This again may be a factor that limits performance of aged people. However, we did an experiment that it was published 2013 where we implanted in 20 patients diffractive multifocal IOLs, and we measured their performance in each eye. So again, it is logMAR data. It's for distance, for intermittent vision, and for near vision with this lens. And we measure with a better eye, no, this is the better eye, because Logmara said it's better as we go down, better eye, worse eye, and with two eyes. And we found that all these people, all this, the average performance was increased in these patients when they used both eyes instead of using even their better eye. So there is an effect of binocularity summation in older subjects. Maybe it has to be studied better or with different methods. Finally, another thing that we may have to investigate better has to do with binocular adaptation and blear adaptation. You all know that when we take out our glasses, the myopes, we cannot see very well in the first minutes, and then our performance slightly improves. I mean, this is shown by this data. Okay, people were in focus. We imagined we made them 2 diopters myopia, myopes, okay, or they removed our glasses, if they were correct, and their visual acuity decreases, and then after adaptation of an hour, we find an improvement of about 1 line. So this is called Blair adaptation. There are some studies showing that Blair adaptation is not affected a lot by aging, but there are not many studies clarifying this. So it's something, again, that needs to be studied better in the future. So to summarize, age-dependent pupil myosis seems to be the optical change that influences most presbyopia correction, if we want to discuss this for multifocal designs or track designs, because it increases depth of focus, which is an advantage, but at the same time, it may decrease retinal illuminance, which is a disadvantage. So pupil has to be studied better. We should not forget that refractive error on the average eye becomes more myopic or less myopic with age, and we also have to remember this. And we do know now that visual function deteriorates with age. There are decreases in visual acuity, in visual field sensitivity, in sensitivity, in darkness, and contrastivity. But these may not be mainly are due to neural changes and not optical changes of the eye. I would like to thank you for your attention. And also this book, because I use data from 2 chapters.